Now, why is it important to plan treatment goals in patients with alcohol use disorders? Now, as most of you would know, having attended the sessions already, alcohol use disorders are chronic disorders. In a large number of people who have alcohol use disorders, they tend to have a relapsing and remitting course of the illness. And so, as a consequence of that, it's very, very important for us as treatment providers to be able to have appropriate goals whenever we are treating patients with alcohol use. So, like I had mentioned, when it comes to understanding the course of alcohol use disorders, there are various ways or various patterns in which alcohol use disorders actually evolve across the lifespan. As we all know, generally people develop alcohol use disorders or alcohol dependence in their youth. And some of the common patterns which actually occur are that people would either persist to have alcohol use disorders throughout their life. In certain individuals, they would have a relapsing and remitting course wherein there would be periods of time where they would be using alcohol and other periods of time where they would not be using alcohol or they would be abstinent. And then there is also one group of people who either suddenly or gradually over a period of time would either reduce or totally stop their use of alcohol. This last phenomenon is something that is called maturing out. So this is what is called the naturalistic course of alcohol use disorders. Essentially, what happens to people with alcohol use disorders, even if they are not treated. Now, the reason why I've put this slide in is it is important to understand that a majority of people, so when you look at studies which have looked at natural recovery in populations, less than 30% of individuals actually recover without formal treatment. And so what I'm trying to say is that a large majority of people require some kind of treatment for their alcohol use disorders. It may not be the same level or same intensity of treatment, but some treatment or some intervention might be required in these individuals. And we will discuss about what are the kind of strategies or what are the kind of things which need to be done for each individual patient. Now, one important point to understand is that especially when the person has more severe alcohol use disorders or more severe dependence, then the chances of the person getting better by himself or recovering by himself come down. So basically, natural recovery is inversely related to the severity of alcohol use disorder. Another important consideration which you guys have to understand is that even for people who actually get better by themselves, who have or fulfill the criteria for alcohol dependence or alcohol use disorder, but then actually get better over time, it does not necessarily mean that all of these individuals stop drinking entirely. So abstinence may not be there in all of these individuals. There may be a number of people who might actually develop dependence, but then subsequently after that return to continued use, but non-problematic use. So, as I said, the reason why I put this slide out there is to help you guys to understand what typically happens to alcohol use disorders, even if there is no intervention that is there, and thereby actually helping you to understand what is the importance of treatment planning in these individuals. Okay, there are a few definitions which I think is important that we should try to understand whenever we are talking about the course of alcohol use disorders. Now, one of the definitions which we use very, very commonly is a term called remission. Okay, so remission is a term which is defined in the DSM-5. DSM-5 is one of the manuals or one of the books which is used for classifying psychiatric illness, including substance use disorders. And so when DSM-5 talks about course of substance use disorders or alcohol use disorders, they say that the term remission, which can be of two types, either partial remission or full remission. So partial remission is when the person is meeting some criteria for DSM-5 substance use disorder, but not enough criteria to make a diagnosis. Okay, a full remission is considered to be there when the person is not meeting any criteria for DSM-5 substance use disorders. Okay, another related term which is used often, particularly in people who are associated with rehabilitation centers and 12-step programs, is a term called recovery. Now, remission is a term which is used more in the medical parlance. It is used more among psychiatrists and mental health professionals. Recovery is a term which is used more in the lay, it's used more in the lay public as well as in treatment programs which ascribe to the 12-step programs, basically. So recovery, if you notice, is not something which is very precisely defined. It generally what studies have said is that it seems to include improved overall health, personal and spiritual growth. It lays an emphasis on personal integrity and truth-telling, and also about contributing to society. So if you look at some of these aspects of what recovery are, these are more in line with what happens in Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous, and other 12-step programs. All right. Now, for the purpose of our presentation, and I think for the purpose of our understanding, we should try to understand the course of alcohol use disorders by using terms like remission, because remission is slightly better defined as compared to a term like recovery. Now, whenever we are talking about treatment planning, one very important step, probably the first step that we need to understand, is what are the kind of outcomes that we are looking for in patients who have alcohol use disorders. Okay, all right. Now, there are various outcomes that a person can use to be able to plan treatment. Now, the most common outcome measures, or the most common outcome parameters that are used, are those to do with drinking behavior. So, is the person abstinent or has the person relapsed? Okay, so that is what is most commonly used by most doctors and most patients to understand treatment outcomes. So like, say for example, a patient or his family will come up to you and they will say this person has got alcoholism or he's got alcohol dependence. And the treatment goals that they would have is they want this person to stop drinking alcohol or be abstinent from alcohol. And if the person has restarted using alcohol, you say that the person has relapsed. Okay. In reality, that is not the way things are. And that is the reason why one needs to be able to understand that there are various types of drinking outcomes or various kinds of outcomes that one needs to actually evaluate when one is planning treatment. These include, even if a person is continuing to drink, you want to find out how often the person is drinking. So that is something that is called the number of drinking days. In addition to that, another measure called the number of heavy drinking days, which is how often does this person drink heavily, or how often does this person binge on alcohol, is another very important measure that we use when measuring outcome. The number of days that the person is completely abstinent is another measure which is used for actually assessing drinking behavior. So the reason why I'm mentioning all of these things is that when we are planning treatment and when we are looking at outcomes of treatment, we should not think very simply in terms of, is this person drinking or is this person not drinking? We need to look in terms of all of these various types of outcomes when we are looking in terms of assessing this person's drinking behavior. Okay. Another way in which treatment outcomes are actually planned, or another way in which treatment outcomes are assessed, is by actually counting the number of DSM-5 criteria for substance dependence or substance use disorder that are met by a patient. Yet another way of being able to actually assess treatment outcome is to look at functioning. And for me personally, I mean, whenever I'm assessing patients and whenever I'm treating individuals and planning their treatment outcomes and planning their treatment goals, I feel that functioning is a very, very important component of being able to understand whether the person is getting better or not. So functioning can be in different domains. So this could be social functioning, it could be interpersonal functioning, it could be occupational functioning. And all of these are things which we should also use as outcomes for our treatment. Now, when we look at broad approaches that are there with regards to treatment, there are two broad approaches which one commonly encounters and which one commonly reads about. These are abstinence-based approaches and harm reduction-based approaches. I will explain a little bit about each of these types or these approaches towards treatment so that you guys have a bit of an idea about this. Now, when it comes to abstinence-based approaches, what, as I've mentioned, and this is something that we usually encounter, the focus is on complete abstinence. So basically, the person should not use the substance at all. The person should not drink at all. That is what an abstinence-based approach entails. So this would include treatment systems like Alcoholics Anonymous as well as rehab centers, where the approach is complete abstinence. The medications or drugs that are used for abstinence-based approaches are deterrent agents like disulfiram. Now, what are the problems with abstinence-based approaches? Now, abstinence-based approaches actually are, they run counter to what our understanding of dependence is. We have already said that substance use disorders or dependence are chronic relapsing conditions where there are changes which actually occur in the person's brain. So if that is the case, then expecting a person to be completely abstinent as the only treatment outcome might be something which may be a bit unreasonable. All right? The other problems that are there with abstinence-based approaches are that usually only people with very high motivation, with very good compliance, with a good amount of family supervision are able to actually go ahead with abstinence-based approaches. And therefore, people who have poor social support, who have a lot of other psychosocial complications might find it quite difficult to be able to do abstinence-based approaches. Another problem that we often encounter in abstinence-based approaches, especially when the person is using disulfiram, is that when people lapse, they have the risk of undergoing disulfiram ethanol reactions. And we know that in many cases, disulfiram ethanol reactions can be quite life-threatening. In addition to this, a lot of people for whom abstinence is the only goal or abstinence is the primary goal that we actually put forward, if the person actually has a lapse or a slip, the person does not actually go back to the previous pattern of drinking but has a lapse, then they can develop what are called abstinence violation effects. These are basically beliefs that the patient has wherein he feels that, oh, because he has actually violated this promise of abstinence that he has made, he will start feeling guilty, he will start feeling shameful about himself, and as a consequence of that, goes on to a full-blown relapse. All right? In addition to this, many of you would have actually encountered people who would have been in the pre-contemplation or contemplation stage of motivation. You would encounter a number of people who would actually say that, doctor sir or madam, we want to cut down, but we don't want to stop drinking entirely. So what about those kinds of patients? Obviously, abstinence-based approaches cannot be utilized for these kinds of individuals. So the reason why I'm trying to help you to, I'm putting forward all of these facts are, I think it is important when you are planning your treatment that you need to be able to understand that there are various different types of approaches that are used for substance use disorders. Abstinence-based approaches are one approach that are used for treatment of alcohol use disorders. The other approaches are also what are called harm reduction-based approaches. So essentially, the difference between abstinence-based approaches and harm reduction-based approaches are that in harm reduction-based approaches, the treatment continues even if the client continues to use the substance or even if the person has lapsed. So the unique things about these kinds of approaches are it allows engagement with people who are, for example, are either in the pre-contemplation or in the contemplation stage of motivation. As far as pharmacotherapy in this case, you utilize what are called anti-craving agents. I think this was discussed in the previous case presentation as well. So people use anti-craving agents like baclofen or naltrexone and camprosate rather than using disulfiram in harm reduction based approaches. And one important fact that one has to consider is that harm reduction based approaches are more in line with what are called the chronic illness model of non-communicable diseases. We increasingly understand that substance use disorders are chronic illnesses just like other non-communicable diseases like diabetes, hypertension, asthma, COPD. These are all chronic illnesses which people suffer from. And they usually, there are periods of time when the illnesses get better, there are periods of time when the illness becomes worse. And so when we understand substance use disorders as a non-communicable disease, then the utilization of harm reduction based approaches are more in line with that. Now, what are the problems with harm reduction approaches? Now, it is contrary to lay concepts of treatment. Now, this is something which I would like to emphasize. See, traditionally, because so much of treatment for substance use disorders and alcohol use disorders has been dominated by systems of treatment such as Alcoholics Anonymous or the moderation movement that was there, which comes from the USA, the Minnesota model of treatment. So generally, the lay concept that most treatment professionals actually have and most of the public actually has with regards to treatment of substance use disorders is that there needs to be complete abstinence. So that is why harm reduction is something which is kind of not in line with that. And so people are like, how can this be treatment? All right. Because of this, because it is contrary to lay concepts of treatment, this model requires a lot of effective communication on part of the doctors, on part of the treating team, to the client as well as the family. So we need to be able to help them to understand how this actually helps people to achieve their treatment goals. All right. The other things, other challenges that are required in this kind of a setting is, it requires compliance over a long period of time. And of course, medications which are associated with treatment in treatment of alcohol use disorders using harm reduction based approaches are much more expensive than, say, agents like disulfiram, which are very, very inexpensive and fairly cheap. So it's important to understand that there are both abstinence as well as harm reduction based approaches which can be used for treatment of patients with alcohol use disorders. Even if there are considerable risks, do not refuse treatment to these kinds of patients who do not agree to a goal of abstinence. So this is the message which I want to actually give to you, so that when you are negotiating your treatment goals with your patients, if the person says that I want to continue drinking, or if he says that I want to still continue to use to a certain extent, not to the same extent, but cut down, please don't lose heart. Don't become disappointed. Don't say that, no, then this cannot work. I will not give treatment to you. This is something that we often tend to do because we feel that what we believe is the best strategy for treatment is this. So we should not deny treatment. We should say that, okay, I believe that treatment with abstinence will probably be the best goal for you for these reasons. However, if you're not willing to work on abstinence for the time being, we need to start off treatment in some method, some form or the other, and we can discuss how we can plan that treatment out. So that is the message that you need to give for patients who may not be willing for a complete goal of abstinence. So this is the way that you need to initiate and engage the person in treatment. When it comes to principles of effective treatment, there are a few things that one needs to keep in mind. One is that one needs to understand that addiction is complex, but it is a treatable disease. It affects brain function and behavior, and the changes that are associated with addiction usually persist even after the person stops using the substances. So even if a person is abstinent, the problems that are associated with addiction can persist beyond the period of abstinence. Okay. Another very important principle of effective treatment is no single treatment is appropriate for everyone. The other important points are treatment needs to be readily available. We know that substance use disorders are associated with fluctuating motivation to change. So when a person is motivated to change, treatment needs to be readily available at that point. Effective treatment attends to multiple needs of the individuals, not just the addiction. So I will tell you that treatments that are required for treating people with addiction is not just about focusing on reducing the person's addictive behaviors, but we need to also keep in mind and consider all other aspects of the person in terms of what is his physical aspects, psychological aspects, other social aspects which may be there, which might also need to be addressed when we are treating an individual with addiction. This is a very important point, that is, remaining in treatment for an adequate period of time is very, very critical. So the best treatment outcomes are seen when the person is in treatment for a longer period of time. And so I think as treatment practitioners, one thing which you need to keep in mind is every effort should be made to ensure that the person continues to be in treatment. That was the reason why in the previous slide, I had talked about why you should not deny treatment to a service user if the person is not agreeing with your goals of treatment. It is very, very important because we understand that if the person is remained in treatment, if they engage in treatment for a long period of time, and many studies have proved this, many studies across the world have looked at this, the longer that the person actually stays in treatment, the better outcomes that the person has. The next thing that one needs to understand is that a treatment plan has to be continuously assessed and reassessed and modified as necessary. So what is very important is, it's not that we have decided one treatment goal or one treatment plan at the beginning of the treatment, and that is the same treatment plan which we will keep following for the rest of the person's treatment. That will not work. We need to keep on continuously assessing the treatment plan and then modifying it based on whatever is the client's requirements. Another very important fact is many patients with addiction have other mental disorders. And so one principle of effective treatment is to diagnose and treat other associated mental disorders. Another very important point which one wants to understand is Withdrawal management is only the first stage of addiction treatment. That even after treatment of withdrawal, the person's addiction is not treated. That one needs to have long-term engagement for effective treatment. In addition to this, one very important point which people kind of misinterpret is that treatment does not always have to be voluntary to be effective. Many times people actually come to treatment because somebody is forcing them to come to treatment. I'm not saying that people lock them up and keep them for treatment, but sometimes what happens, a person might actually have an accident. Because of that, the police has gotten involved. That is the reason why they have come for treatment. They have gotten into some sort of legal problems. That is why they have come for treatment. It is important to understand that these periods of time are when one really needs to try to push treatment on individuals. And often when people are joining treatment at this period of time, this can be very effective if we engage with them in a proper way during this period of time. Treat them with respect, treat them in an appropriate way at this period of time. Also, one has to understand that substance use needs to be monitored continuously during treatment. And treatment should also include testing for other physical health conditions such as infections as well as chronic health conditions. So therefore, components of effective treatment would include all of these: intake, detoxification, pharmacotherapy, behavioral therapy, case management, continuing care, monitoring of substance use, and as well as the use of self-help and peer support groups. And the kinds of services that are required for effective treatment would include mental health services and medical services, but would also include educational services, services for AIDS and HIV, legal services, financial services, housing services, as well as family and child care services. Okay. So whenever one is actually planning treatment, one needs to look at two things. One is how severe this person's alcohol use disorder is, and what are the kinds of treatment settings that are available. So the person can have a spectrum of severity from what is called at-risk drinking to very severe alcohol use disorder. And we need to be able to assess where on the spectrum of severity that the person lies. Similarly, we need to be able to understand what are the various levels of care which are available. So there are early interventions which are usually provided by primary care physicians, usually provided by lay counselors. Then there are typical outpatient services. Then there are what are called intensive outpatient services. Then there are residential services, which are what is usually seen in rehab facilities and therapeutic communities. And then you have medically managed intensive inpatient services, which is what is the tertiary care hospital generally. So one needs to be able to match the severity of the problem that the person is having to the kind of care that the person is having. So for example, if the person is just having at-risk drinking, you would not want to manage him as an inpatient. You would just want to manage him with some early intervention, brief interventions are what you would want to do. If the person has mild degree of alcohol use disorder or no history suggestive of severe withdrawal, you would prefer outpatient services rather than directly moving the person into intensive inpatient services. If the person has very, very severe alcohol use disorder with a lot of complications, lot of psychological as well as physical complications, you would prefer medically managed inpatient services. So you need to be able to determine what are the kind of services that the person requires depending on the severity of the alcohol use disorder that the person has. These are the typical treatment goals that the person would have with alcohol use disorders. First is to stabilize the acute medical conditions, increase motivation for recovery, treatment for chronic medical and psychiatric conditions, and to enhance coping as well as relapse prevention skills, and finally to improve overall functioning. This is what we usually do when we actually plan treatment for individuals who come with alcohol use disorders. This is what would constitute a comprehensive treatment plan. So there would be an initial phase of detoxification where there would be management of acute physical and psychiatric complications. Then there would be a phase wherein we tackle the neuroadaptation related to chronic alcohol use. So like we had mentioned that people continue to have problems even after stopping their alcohol use. So some of the problems related to addiction persist even after stopping alcohol use. And so just withdrawal treatment is not sufficient to deal with this neuroadaptation. So there is a requirement for pharmacotherapy as well as psychotherapy to deal with this long-standing problems which are there in people with alcohol use disorders. The third step that we lay a lot of emphasis on is assessing and treating vulnerability. That is both in terms of temperamental vulnerabilities as well as psychiatric comorbidities. Finally, we need to focus on making a lapse or relapse plan. And then finally, we have to enhance support, which is through family support, peer support, as well as community and occupational rehabilitation. So basically, like we have mentioned, you guys have already discussed about withdrawal management. So this is the kind of treatments that are used for withdrawal. After that, we use agents like acamprosate, naltrexone, baclofen, and topiramate, as well as ondansetron for pharmacological management of relapse prevention. We then also use psychosocial interventions such as habit reversal, structuring of activities of daily living, looking for alternative highs, focusing on adequate structure in day-to-day life, as well as physical exercise and yoga. And then we use other strategies like medications for treating vulnerability, as well as behavioral strategies such as brain training, neurofeedback, and treatment of other comorbidities. Finally, it is very important to plan for relapse. So usually we advocate using a single therapist, enforce frequent monitoring as well as follow-up. We make a contingency plan and we enhance social support as well as the safety net. Finally, it is very, very important to engage family by educating them, have collaborative goals to do contingency-based management, as well as focus on quality time and family therapy. So in summary, treatment planning should be done to assess the severity of alcohol use and map available resources. It should be individualized and should try to match the severity of alcohol use to the level of care. And it should be dynamic and should change with the changing needs of the patients.